had a film job, I believe, down in Georgia. And when I got the call from Aaron, I said, my God, it's 2 hours away, and I'll be there. And for those of you who don't know me, I was the Hawk on Buck Rogers in 25th Century, second season, and did 13 episodes in that season. Gil, Aaron, Tweaky all established the first year, which was the fourth season. But that's the history of it, and I can't believe that 31 years later, people are still interested in the character. It kind of bowls you over. I said to Gil when we were in Oklahoma about 2 months ago at a very big convention, I spoke to 5,000 people, over 5,000 people in like 2.5 days. And George Takei was there, the Star Trek crew was there, and I couldn't believe the devotion of sci-fi fans. It was amazing, just amazing. And I kind of like to hear from you folks, any questions immediately, or kick off right from there. Any? Yes.
Did you get to keep any of the props from your season?
No, I didn't. It was only because of the fact that the initial story was, when they told us that they were going to cancel it after 13 weeks, they wanted, they being Universal, and John Mantley, the executive producer who created the concept of the Hawk, which I'll get into very, because it's really fascinating. They said they want to keep everything in reserve just in case they revive it. And about 4 or 5 months ago, I got an email from a gentleman in Las Vegas who's created a museum of superheroes, science fiction heroes, and he's in the process of now piecing together different portions of the uniform. But he bought from Universal, which had to cost him a fortune, I'm sure they weren't, you know, polite about what they were going to charge him, the shield, the breastplate. Because I had a breastplate and a backplate. And that breastplate and backplate are actually my body in 1980, yes, in the June of 1980 is when I flew out to the coast when they said I had the role. And the first thing they said is, you have an appointment tomorrow morning in the special effects department and they'll have a bikini for you. So I had to put this bikini on, got onto a slab, and they made a mold of my entire body. And of the head, for the headpiece, and they made the whole body because they wanted to go, they didn't know how deep they were going to go with the breastplate, and they wanted to be able to fit on my contours of the body. And the end result is what you saw on television, but it's 7 layers of polyurethane. We just kept laying polyurethane layers for the back and the front. So Jack Takei, who was my dresser, incredible guy. He'd been in the business 1,000 years before I met him, but he had more energy than the whole studio. The guy, you couldn't stop him. And he'd come into the trailer, and 1, 2, 3, he'd have me all laced up into it. And what started off at about an hour and a half to get ready, we brought down to 45 minutes, and it was wonderful. And that was one of the good thinking from the designing standpoint, to have the piece just fit. There was never any adjusting, just boom, 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 and I got into it. John Mantley, so that answers your question. I can't right, I'll drift, I will drift. John Mantley was the executive producer of the show, and when John, that's the second year, when he came in, John Mantley, he had conceived of the Hawk. As a survivor of the island of Aku, there's a Thor Heyerdahl book, many, since I'm the oldest person in the room here, many years ago, in the early 50s, Thor Heyerdahl wrote a book called Kon-Tiki, where he went in the South Pacific from Europe on a, literally, a raft that was made of what he would think one would travel centuries and thousands of centuries before. And the book is phenomenal. He made it all out of like hemp and straw and bamboo. And then subsequently, around 1959, he went to the islands, the Easter Islands. Because the question is, you know, the big monoliths that sit on Easter Island with a long face. To this day, no one really knows how they got there. Now, it is in the same latitude of Peru. So the belief is that they were brought by flatboat across those thousands of miles in the Pacific from Peru, from South America, Aztec, etc. But Thor Heyerdahl went into explanation in Aku, AKU-AKU. Around the base of the statues are bird people, literally like the hawk. Faces, plumed heads, no wings, and fully sculpted bodies. And this is what he wanted. And his only other request, I'll never forget the day that I read for him, and he said to everybody, I want to read with him. They flew me in from New York, and I was at Universal, and he said, I want to read with Thom. And because not only being a great writer, his career was in the 40s as a young man. He did a lot of movies in Rome as a producer-director, wrote some American films there. He was also an actor. He was Canadian-born. I love the man. He was an incredible man. He's now passed on. And we read several scenes, and then it culminated with Corey and Hawk in the death scene in the cave. For those folks who don't know, there's a wonderful, beautifully written scene with Corey, who I had killed, basically my wife, by using the talons of my ship to capture the searcher, and I plunge it into her when I go into the searcher. So she's on her slab dying, and the scene, it's just really beautiful. I know in the shooting of it, we had to do it four times because, and this is the ultimate compliment for an actor, the camera operator, the man who really does the final thing, just looking in that and moving the camera and tear it up every time. And they had to stop and wipe his eyes, and I've got to stop this. I couldn't stop, and so at one point they let him, you know, cry. And I was really very, very flattered. It was very, very flattering. And I went off on that tangent for a reason. Why did I go off on that tangent that just now? I was telling you. Oh, when John. So John reads it with me. John started to cry in the scene in his office, this big, big office. The producers are there, executives from Universal. He puts the script down. It's beautiful. And he turned around and goes, it's his, it's what I want. And I was like, my God, really? You know, you go, in the business, you have to usually wait weeks and days to find out if you've gotten the role. And we went back to his office, and that's when he told me about Aku Aku. He was shocked that I knew the book, Aku Aku. He said, really? No, I said, yes. And he goes, the only other request that I have, and it's so funny, he said, there was a film several years ago, and I was listening, and he said, with Yul Brynner and George Takaris, and I said, Gods of the Sun. And it was 1963. And he goes, you know it? And I said, yes, it was the Aztec. It's a film that, does anybody maybe hear of it or know of it? You remember? Yeah, I liked it. It didn't do well, but I liked it. And it's Aztec, about the Aztecs. And Yul Brynner, who was incredible, and I've seen him on, I saw him on stage, The King and I, had a walk in it, and John got up, and John was very natty, mustache, clothes, beautiful dressed suit. He made a scotch for the two of us at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. He said, we've got to celebrate, so he opens a bottle of scotch, and we're both having the scotch, and he says, it's that walk that I want, that Brynner had, you know, that kind of thrust of the pelvis. Okay. So that was kind of incorporated into Hawk. For me as an actor, the fun thing was when I went back to New York and started doing the research, knowing that we weren't going to get into production for a while, and also strike, the actor strike of that year, 1980, held everything for 3 months, and it gave me more time just to do research. I studied the birds, both in the Museum of Natural History, and so I was a big runner, a big, big jobber. Every morning, if not in the evening as well, and we lived, or we had an apartment at that time right across from Central Park in the 90s, so I'd go into the tennis court entrance and run the reservoirs. And I found myself just studying birds. And I was trying to incorporate into the character that aspect, as well as the thrust of the pelvis that John talked about. And people have commented on it that they sense a bird, you know, I can't imitate a bird, but there is the wonderful thing, if you look at a bird, it knows where it wants to go, focuses and goes all within a billionth of a second, so in, and it knows what it's going to pick up. Very fascinating thing, when I was in Oklahoma doing the last bird, that big trek in August, July, a husband and wife team brought a series of birds. They couldn't bring them in for insurance purposes by the promoter. They brought in these incredible hawks and a bird that I could not believe grows to 7 feet long, has a 14-mile focus, and they brought the baby, which was this big, and I had it perched on my arm. The hope was that when I got up to do the very big theater I spoke in, that when I got up to do the Q&A, that I would say hawk, and I'd have my aunt, and they'd let the hawk go, and he'd fly and land on my arms. Gorgeous hawk, but they couldn't notice, as I said, well, understandably concerned that something happened. But they did bring this, and I went out into the lobby. I took it upon myself. This bird is just unbelievable. And I watched, and it, again, I said, how do you know when it's focusing? It can pick up, in its talons, a fox. That's its primary source of, it would never hurt a rabbit though. It would never go after a rabbit. It's just the species, the primary, it sees 14 miles away a fox, the focus is in and takes off. It's monstrous. The baby was monstrous. It was really very fascinating. So it was elements like that that I began to learn from birds. And one other thing, I had a heavy dance background in college, been able to playhouse. It's a subtlety, and once I say it, people say, oh my God, I never used my hands or arms in anything I did in the show. Most of the fighting was with my legs, or running up like the one at Oasis, climbing the walls. I never gripped the rocks. They'd let me get up there before so I could know where I was going to go. I knew in my head, I marked off which rocks were the most secure. And whenever I went up anything like that, I just used my legs. Climbed, kept the body straight, and like a bird. Bird doesn't have arms, and it doesn't use its wings for anything like that. It uses its two claws. And it was elements like that I just got so, it's fun. That's the fun and joy of being an actor, doing that kind of research. And that's how the character really evolved. And now I'll wait for the question about the headpiece. Anybody have a question? About the head, yes.
I was going to ask how uncomfortable that was to wear a long time.
The headpiece, totally comfortable. Once it was on, I even forgot about it. What was interesting, and not many people know this, the best feathers to use for anything costume-wise are, if you're using it consistently like I was, are chicken feathers. They have the most oil in them, and I would constantly, let's say, for instance, Time of the Hawk, when the hawk and buck face off each other. Now, it wasn't me, it was my stunt double, but all the close-ups were me. So my stunt double would do all the hard work, and I would then get on the ground and do the acting. And it's that double flip type. If there's the first episode, kind of open up, character is introduced, there's a wonderful battle they have on the mountaintop, in the heights, and Gil comes up and they face off with each other. There's a wonderful flip. Randy Clare, who is now a minister in Northern Washington State, and he got out of the business completely. He was a brilliant artist, but his primary, very large family. But Randy, only because of physically we were the same, but they would give him my headpiece from the previous week, because I had to change it every week. It would last just about a week. And they would give him my previous week's headpiece. But the funny thing about it was, and in that fight sequence that happened, I don't have a particularly small nose, and they had to make a prosthetic for his nose, because he had a little turned up nose, and they took a mold of my nose and made it for him. So in all of the shots, the long shots of the fighting sequences, it's the nose. And the first time they used it was on the mountaintop sequence in the first episode, Time of the Hawk, and it came off. And it was the funniest thing to see him do this backflip twice. No preparation, he just went and flips backwards. And all of a sudden his nose is bouncing on the mountaintop. Makeup was there, and they re-glued it and recolored it and everything. But those are the tricks of the trade. But the headpiece never presented a problem. They blended in the morning. That took the longest time. And as I said, the mold was there. The mold still exists. I've seen it. The mold still exists. And because I did a lot of work for Universal over the years in television. And the feathers can be brushed very easily, as I started to say, because chicken feathers just smooth right out. So I'd be in the fight sequence, that they'd all be messed up in a close-up, but Brenda Todd, the head makeup artist, would just come over and go, or maybe lick her fingers and then just do it, and the pieces all went back into position again. It's an interesting thing to learn. It has the most oil. I'm sorry? The breastplate was made of polyurethane, as I said. What no one realized, which was startling, I think it was Journey to Oasis was the first outdoor shooting we did. It was a two-parter. And we were shooting late into the night. Well, I literally began to shake. I mean, they couldn't shoot. It was so cold. Once the sun is down, the piece becomes a refrigerator. So they brought in cherry picker, moved the cherry picker in closely, and the prop guys were so beautiful. There was no way to wrap it because they were doing these shots from down above, me climbing the wall, or pinned against the wall. They just held the blankets over me. They pushed the cherry picker. I'm standing here for about 45 minutes, and these guys just took rotation, putting the blankets around me. But conversely, the next day, we were shooting at the height of maybe 98, 100, 105 degrees, they had to pour ice cubes down the front and the back because it became hot. It was something no one anticipated. And they said, you know, we can remake it. That's silly because we're not going to be shooting outside that much in this kind of heat. And it wasn't even a drawback, but it was something we had to constantly be aware of. It was always then put on the production sheet, blankets, hawk, exterior. So they knew that we were going to shoot in the night. They had to put a blanket on it. It would have been a refrigerator. Yeah. Questions?
We have other videos. Yeah, he's doing the show.
When you were doing your lines for the show, I noticed that you went from the enemies with luck to a very devoted friend. Was that a difficult transition for you to do? Because you give your life to him by the end of my run.
Geez, I'm glad you picked up on that. Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, no, it wasn't because I can give you now some inside information. When they thought of the hawk, and I give this credit to the writers and to John Mantley, and my satisfaction as an actor, and the generosity of Gil and Aaron, I mean, suddenly they're doing a show that has been changed completely. They've established a year earlier, through some great work, a different kind of show. And I get very emphatic about this when people say, you know, this was better or that was better. It's not about better, it's just different. It's what I call the actor's theatrical rhythm. The first season had a very fast-paced, wonderful kind of joyous rhythm to it. Gil was funny. It was spectacular to look at the television in that time. I can remember, we're all spoiled now, or a younger generation is spoiled by computer-generated genius. And when John came in, he said he wanted more of an ensemble and he wanted it darker. There were scripts that NBC turned down. They had to rewrite. Now, I would get the original script, and by the time we got to shoot it and do it, it was changed completely. The feeling was that they were getting too mystical, or you were getting too Greek. John had one thing about death and the Greeks, and it was very, very powerful, but they said, it's too much to throw at the audience. That's not what it is. It's science fiction. I think Gil's greatest performance is the satyr. When he turns into the satyr, it's actually, I think about the 10th show. And I'm doing this to answer your question, that I was only really in the first 3 or 4 episodes. And the others, I would just kind of brush through. They didn't know where the character was going. And one morning, early on in the shooting, we took an apartment, my wife and I, just across from Universal, being a kind of cautious, neurotic New York actor, that just in case there was a breakdown or something, I could walk through the parking lot, which is like 10 miles long, but I could hook up with one of that's where the crews, the technical crews, and just get on one of their buses. So I could just literally go across the road. This is in Burbank, California, Universal. I'm sleeping, the phone rings at 7 o'clock, and they said they need me on the set. And I said, but I'm not supposed to shoot today, I haven't even got a script. They said, John came down, and the phone calls, and the messages coming, telegrams coming in to Universal, they want you just to stand and take a shot. Don't worry about making the costume perfect. No close-ups. Just get the costume on, let them slip it up. We don't even have to blend or anything. Because that's, as I said, the blending everything's piece. And it's going to be a long shot, but we're going to see you over the bay, the launching bay of the searcher. They have to at least see you. And then while that was happening, they started rewriting all the remaining scripts and adding the characters we went along. I condensed in the first 4 scripts that I had the transition with Gil that you so very smartly picked up on. I'm very glad to thank you. That I said, I don't have much time to make this commitment, and it has to be, and this is Vincent McAveen, one of the greatest, and I say this, I've done a lot of work, guys, greatest television directors I've ever worked with. The whole McAveen family, his nephews, he produced Mel Gibson's The Passion. He produces a lot of Mel Gibson's films. And he was like a kid when I was doing it on the show. But Vincent just didn't... We hit it off immediately. His tower was about that big. Lanky. Sterling reputation. Vincent just didn't shoot the character of the whole. What he did was presented. And there's a big difference when that compliment is given to you in film or television. The character is presented. He built everything, and we talked about it, and he said, the moment when you're on the searcher and Goodfellow, everybody is talking to you about coming with them, joining in their mission, I have to see. We don't have the time, script-wise. I don't even think he said to me bluntly. He's very straightforward. He said, I don't think you're in the last 5 or 6 scripts. You don't even exist. And believe me, after this is done, you're going to exist. I know it. And because we shot this near the end, and in the first episode, Tom of the Hawk, the introduction of the character, there's a moment when they say, and Gil says, comes up to me and he says, come with us, be one of us. And I was so chilled by it. Starfield is behind us, and they play Corey's voice saying, Paul, my love, go with me. Go. And I walk, and Vincent was gorgeous. I mean, he just said, the camera is going to follow you. Don't follow the camera. You know, an actor can follow, no, just senses where the camera is. He said, forget it completely. Forget the camera. It's going to follow you. You take all the time you want. To make that, in that walk, we have to see your decision. And it was pretty startling. It was a good 15, 20 seconds. You know what that is on camera? Silence? That's like 5 hours. And I go from left to the portal. He then brings the cameras around, and through the portal, you see my face and you hear Corey, and you know the decision is made. And that's what made me then make the transition to be guardian of Hawk and Wilma. And that paid off later on in the thing, we're shooting something. That was again, I was saved by Gil's stuntman. I've given you all the little things that happened. We were shooting right on the set, on the lot, back lot of Universal, series of holes, and they had planted all these explosions. I did not know, it was my own fault, that the explosion was going to be where it was going to be. And I'm standing right there, you really get hurt. And I did Gil's stuntman just took both of us down into the hole and covered us. He was pretty well battered by this flying debris, took us both down into the hole. But what he did, which was so clever, is that we knew the timing, and the explosions that weren't there, there were like 8 of them. And in my head I said, I know the 7th explosion, I throw my arms out. I've done it several times with Wilma, and he throw my arms out as if they are wings and protect him. And Ted Vendrell, I think was his name, he did that. He just copied what I do and came down on top of us. And it was they kept it in. It's just a wonderful effect. Yes. It's time? Okay, and I'm going to end on a very funny note. I was telling you about Vincent McAveedy, and this is like an inside story. I've given inside stories your actor's life. We were shooting maybe a third or fourth episode, I don't remember what it was, and Vincent did like 5 of them. And it's where I'm leading, I think the Changelings or something like that, I'm leading the group, Doctor, Wolfhard White, Buck, Wilma, I take the lead, I'm coming down, and I let them pass me by because I know we're being chased by these aliens, and I stand ground, and I take out my taser, and we start shooting, right? Now, the whole corridor has been wired with spots that will later on, they'll explode, and they'll be rotoscoped in the studio. That's how they did it then. They put the rays going from the guns and hitting all these tabs, these explosive tabs. So I get into position, I do it, and suddenly the sound bell rings. When there's a sound problem, the sound man rings his bell, bing, 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 everything stops. And he says over the mic, I'm picking up a strange sound. Now they go back and they have to rewire, so that takes a half hour. They've got to rewire everything. Because normally you do this in one shot. Same thing, we've been running down the hallway, I get them past me, I stand there, I see them, I take out my taser and I'm there, and I start tasering, they're tasering back, goes off again, that is picking up the sound. This happened 3 times. The 4th time we do it, Vincent stops it. Cut, cut, and I was sensing he was almost on top of me. And he walks over to me and he goes, do you know what you're doing? And I said, what do you mean? Good, I'm looking up at it. Yeah, I'm protecting the crew and Buck and Wilma and taking on the aggressors. And he said, no, do you realize what you're doing with your mouth? And he says it in a good-natured way, but he could, and what, thank you, what I was doing, you know, as a kid, when you stand there, you're like this, I don't know, I did it, you know. So I'm standing there going, he goes, he comes down, he bends down to me, and he goes, because I froze, I'm like this, the director said, I'm standing, and I'm just like this, and he goes, you are going. What is so he gives a big hug, kiss in the head. After that, I'd be walking on the Universal lot or something and someone would go it spreads in 5 minutes. Things like that just spread and then they call the tower and they tell them, you know, you'd be in the elevator and be an executive. So it kind of spreads. Listen folks, thank you so much for listening to this. The history of the Hawk and Buck Rogers. I'm sorry, Gil isn't here. He's got some good stories. And just thank you very, very much. I'm enjoying the day.